in the sky, gazing far into the night. I raise my hand to the fire, but it's no use, 'cause you can't stop it from shining through. It's true, baby, let the light shine through. If you believe it's true, baby, won't you let the light shine through for you.
Deception Detection Radio. I'm Kay.
And I'm Chad.
We pray you all had a blessed week. It's our pleasure to welcome Michael Herr to Deception Detection Radio. Welcome, Michael. Thank you so much for coming on with us. How are you?
I'm very good today. How are you today?
Absolutely wonderful. Thank you.
Oh, it's been a very, very long, long day for me.
It sounded hectic.
Yeah, it started at 5 in the morning, and it's probably going to go on till 5 in the morning. It's kind of how it goes.
Oh, you'll be sleeping and walking and getting everything done.
Yeah, I sleepwalk a lot.
I've got a son that sleep eats. He will walk, he will do everything, he'll talk with you, but he's asleep, and he gets up and cooks in the middle of the night.
I do. I make coffee. For my wife, I have to. She'll yell at me, but no, I'm just kidding. She won't yell at me. I'm I do that because she. By the time I'm done with what I need to get done, she's waking up for work. So I just make the stuff and just make her coffee and go upstairs. Pretty much. I mean, wait till she gets home and you spend the quality time. But unfortunately, me, to be honest with you, I don't get to spend as much time with my wife as I would love to. That's actually my fault because it's just a lot of work. She knows that, so she's not stressed on that, you know. So at least that's a good thing. She understands a lot of what I do, so that's a good thing. At least I have someone I can trust, which is ultimately all you can really expect in marriage. Is the best marriage is when you can just trust the person you're with. That if you can be that friend, good. That's all they want. You know, they want a friend. They want someone they can trust. You know, they know everybody's got weaknesses, but the bottom line is trust. Trust. I always say that. It's trust.
That's right.
It's marriage. It's 100% trust. You know, it can, a lot of people don't know that. They, like, get married for looks and stuff, and it's like, yeah, you can do that, but you'll find out later, and you may find out the hard way.
That doesn't last.
So trust is always a good thing.
Well, I'm going to go ahead and say tonight's opening prayer, and then we're going to get in and talk about some very interesting topics. So, are we all ready?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us all together, and thank you for letting us have this opportunity to fellowship with Michael Herr. Let everyone's ears be opened so that they may hear your words, and open their hearts, Lord, soften them so that your word may be etched upon them. Please place a hedge of protection around all of us, around all of the equipment, and just make sure that nothing dark can interfere, Lord, with anything tonight. And we ask too, Lord, that you just lead tonight's broadcast. Make every word your word. And we ask this, Father, in Jesus' holy and mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay.
Well, Michael, we were talking a little bit before the broadcast, getting into the topic of CERN and all the different things associated with it. But first, can you tell us a little bit about yourself, and then we can go into those topics?
Well, my expertise is basically in ecclesiastical biblical study and theology. I was also trained to be a journalist and a writer, and I was trained to be an investigative journalist, and I was trained to do field work. And basically, that was a culmination of studying for education, and I dedicated it to the service of God. So what I wanted to do was learn about as much of the Bible as I could, learn about the past as much as I could, and then do field work in order to study that. That type of work took, I would say, about 10 years before I got to a seminary school. When I got to seminary school after 10 years, I was there for about 4 years. I completed the course there to become a theologian, but I had a falling out with the Church of Christ set. And that falling out was due to doctrinal issues I had with them and several debates I had with them that went behind closed doors. I'm not allowed to talk too much about it because they don't want their names, but I can say I defeated them. And during that, we became divided, basically. And that entailed me to start my own study on more about the Bible and more what was lacking, and I teamed up with other people at that time. And at that time, they started relaying to me more information about NASA and many of the cover-up aspects. And this is when I was meeting military people at the time. And these were mostly retired folks, or some of the folks were still working there. But they already had a hub that they created decades. Like, the hub was created in the late 50s, and they were just, continuing it on with it. And they had, different groups. Some of them were Christian groups. Some of them were just, into that study. And I started learning more and more from them. And that started to pull what's called, networking. And that's how I got into networking. And networking is when you learn more about information. And that's sort of like a six-degree separation science, if you will. If you meet somebody who knows somebody in the industry or in these type of fields, and they can direct you on where to go. And then not only that, but once you get that info, you got to go to those locations and find out if what you're hearing coincides with what you can find on your own. And that's establishing witness, motivation, and evidence. And that's basically what I do. I basically could have done different things. I could have been a detective if I wanted to, but that just not, it's different things you can do with that. People go into media with that, but I just got into basically establishing a ministry. Why? Because it was needed at the time. It really was. Because I saw what was going on with church, and I saw how a lot of people with gifts were just being basically brushed aside. They were basically being taken out, or basically they had to sell out their convictions. I just couldn't do that. So I just thought to myself, people need, to be told the truth. And it was really just done as, at the time I couldn't understand it, but I realized that God showed me that it was really done to edify people and to teach people the truth. And that's where my background is that I really trained myself to really learn through the Holy Spirit as much as where the Holy Spirit can take me, on whatever field it can take me, and on whatever thing I can learn and adapt with that. And that's really where that came from, was just to drive to just, learn more. That's really who I am, in a nutshell. It's just where education was taken from. And at that point, I just basically relied on God to help me learn. I was gifted at it, but I couldn't stay with it because they were not teaching the truth. And I felt like some people needed to step up, because it was time. And there was a lot of good people out there, and I felt they deserved the truth at the very least. That if you are somebody that can teach, you're somebody that can do that, you're responsible to them. The part that the people I broke away with didn't understand is that we are responsible to them. It's not so much as they're responsible for themselves, because they are responsible for themselves, but at the same time, we're responsible to help them if we are capable of doing that. If we can show that we have something to contribute to their lives, we should contribute it without arguing about it, about the finer points. And the finer points always went back to the world's rhetoric, evolution and what the media will say is true or not. And I got into a lot of spites with that, am I supposed to ask Dan Rather what I'm supposed to say here? Am I supposed to go down to the University of Oxford, ask the British sets, what I'm supposed to say here? I mean, would you like me to go ask the Pope what I'm supposed to say here? I mean, it was pretty stupid at times, and I didn't like arguing with them. I can tell you that. I didn't find pleasure in it. It was actually quite, I can laugh about it now because my spirit is different now, But back then it was hard. It was ugly. You know, it was a feeling of, and this was coming from the church set, that, you know, you're a sellout, you're a loser, you're a traitor, you're a Benedict Arnold. That's how they looked at me, for just telling people what the Bible was saying the whole time. And even when I presented the evidence, and even when I presented my essay, and even when I presented my format, they still, with their ignorance, and this became a problem. And this is what gave me the impression that something else is going to have to start, that there's going to have to be another revival, because that's how revivals start, is that when the church is failing the people, because it's usually because they become too leisurely and they become too accepted of a status quo and not respect the fact when Jesus says winds change, that there's be changes on the wind, and that in every period, in every age, it isn't saying God changes his word. It's just to say the times change, so different, so knowledge that was always from the beginning comes back again. And we were at this point where this knowledge from the beginning, which we did lost sight of for a long time, is now coming back at us. And now we have to learn, because we're having this problem with people being abducted, people being haunted, people being possessed, people being attacked. We got mind control evidence, and we traced that out of Canada, and we had all this evidence to show there's a major spiritual attack going on the people, and it's a major spiritual attack that's being covered up, and it's not being covered up by your local politician, it's being covered up at the highest front, military intelligence. The very force that keeps us free is involved, and I know it's sensitive to people, so I always felt like what we have to do, if we're real Americans, if we really believe that we're Christians and that we truly love this country, that there are things we have to do, rather if we don't like to do it or not, you know, rather people don't appreciate it or not, that it just has to be done, you know, regardless. Because the eyes, history does have eyes, you know, and the people who make history are just, they're just like spokes on a wheel. They're really nothing. It's how the people is going to perceive it. It's just what's going to testify to that, if that was really God's work or not. Because remember, two witnesses are gathered, and there I am with them.
Yes.
So one does something, and the other is responding to it in the way they do. That's God, and that's the foreground of our spiritual evidence that we really were on the right track. So that's pretty much it.
Could you also let everyone know about Shield of the Sun? Because you do, it's an amazing broadcast.
How that came about, I was living in the Y, because at that time I had nothing. very, very broke and very, very devastated. My whole career was pretty much, you know, about to go through the window. And somebody was talking about biblical passages in Psalm about David representing the spirit of the Shekinah as a shield. The Shekinah is the Holy Spirit. It's what you know as the Son of God, or the Spirit of the Son of God. And so while we're talking about the manifest, I was like, you know, just bouncing it around, and then we didn't know what to name. I personally did not know what to name it. My friend Jay came to me and said to me, we're going to do this channel, and we're going to call it Shield of the Sun. That's what he said to me. And the channel was literally created to teach people many different subjects that you don't know in church. Basically, Shield of the Sun is, if you want to know real Bible, that's one of the channels you can go to watch it. If you want to know what real entertainment is like, there are certain videos on that channel that can really tell you that. If you want to know about different facets of spiritual things, you know, that's a channel where you can go where it can biblically reveal that to you. That's what it was created to do. It was created to tell people things that they're dealing with every single day. I guess you can say God created that, because it wasn't even my idea. I remember just sitting back thinking we should do something, but there's nothing to do but to sit here and, you know, shout it to our lungs fall out, you know, and we're kind of joking about it. But this guy had a serious mindset of, no, we're just going to make this channel and just do it. And I remember telling him, well, you know what? If we get 2 subscribers, I'll do it. I'll do it for the rest of my life.
And look at you now. Wow.
that funny? Like I said, we'll just do, I didn't think that was it, but I just thought, okay, because at the time I didn't know a lot about YouTube, the YouTube community or the remote community. I didn't know about it. Like I knew some things, but so much of my work was on field that it was like in the trenches. So when I'm coming out of the trenches, it's like I'm back in this setting where it's pretty much like a prison I'm living in, but we're going to be doing this. And I said to myself, okay, well, if we get two people to work, that I didn't, because I didn't think anyone would watch it. But I said, if we get two people, I'll do it permanently, because it's two people that God has just saved. So, okay. And then the next thing it just, yeah, it started growing and growing and growing and growing and growing. And it was like, oh my God, this is bigger than us. Like, even my friend couldn't take it. He ended up quitting sometime less than a year into it. Like, I've been doing this now for 5 years. In terms of the channel, I've been doing the work for 20 years. So, but he just, he couldn't take it. I don't, I got nothing but respect for him because he actually did. God actually used him to create the idea to make the channel. Like, to literally come to me and go, I'll film you, just do what you're doing. And it, so major props to him for that. That's really what Shield of the Sun is. It's spelled that way to represent the psalm of the way David talked about God. That every time David went into battle, he always felt that he had a shield around him, like something invisible, because he would account like spikes and swords that should have chopped his head off, just didn't, it never reached him, or it just didn't touch him, or something would happen to the sword, and it just, he would account these things all the time, how these angels literally would encamp him, surround him, and anything, rather if it was battle or politics or whatever it was, that he could just account that when you have, and that's how I felt at the time, and I think that was appropriately named because we were coming into an avenue where we're completely outnumbered, totally. Like, no one really believes us at this point in terms of what we're teaching. And it was really that type of deal, that it's me coming out there with the small group that I have, facing down like 20,000 unbelievers and then some. That it was like, okay, well, Shield of the Sun, because you're going to need it. That's pretty much that's how they got forged. Yeah, that's pretty much how it came about.
Anyone that's listening that hasn't had the opportunity to listen, you need to tune in to YouTube to Shield of the Sun. It's all one word, and sun is spelled SON. You will not regret tuning in. It's excellent.
Thank you. Thank you. I
Oh, you're
appreciate that.
welcome. It's just the
Thank you.
truth. Now, tonight, we've got a few topics that we are going to cover with CERN and some of the things that CERN entails, like, well, also aliens from hell first, but then getting into CERN and Gothard Tunnel, the portals and fairies with stingers, and wherever else this topic may take us. And then we're going to switch gears halfway through. So, would you like to talk a little bit about your video, Aliens Are From Hell?
How that video came about was it was actually a labor of love for us that was completely robbed. So that's the part I'm sad about. But the part that's positive about it was this, that it was a collection of video evidence that we basically either got ourselves or we got from others. And most of it came from others. Some of it we legworked ourselves. Either way, we had what's called a cultumation. And we were like, well, most of the people who gave us videos at the time, they did not know how to explain it. It was like they were seeing things out there and more things than they were seeing things that I was trying to capture, which I was like, that was driving me crazy because I'd get there and they already saw it. Anyway, so when I get there, they just didn't know what it was. And then when I stopped doing that, because I didn't do that for very long in terms of field work and everything. But it was like, because I was always doing different things at the same time. So I was on the field a lot. But one thing I do recall was every time someone brought these videos back, they were going, what is this? Can someone explain this? Can someone explain this? Can someone explain that? So we were looking at these videos, and then Jay was like, let's just do a documentary where you just explain this. And it would just, you know, he actually wanted to do it where we're just explaining all these different things. And I thought we should probably do it where we can make it like a format that we're going to talk about what the doctrine is biblically about everything we'll see in these videos, so that people can at least have a broad understanding of what I'm saying and then go back into the Bible and read it themselves, which would just reinforce what I'm saying, and then they can go and realize what they're watching. We wanted to make an alien video that actually explains the phenomenon biblically. That was really the premise of that idea, because there wasn't a whole lot of other stuff going on with that. And there wasn't too many people explaining it that way. And that's really where I came from with that. That was the premise of why we did it, was we saw all these videos and documentaries. I had not seen probably one documentary I can recall which talked about the phenomenon under interdimensional terms, Christian terms, and used the Bible to explain what they were doing. But that was like one out of maybe like 1,000 or so, maybe 2,000 maybe, that were just alien garbage. It was like so much of the science was not even true. It was one of the things I noticed was like watching it, I was like, I can't believe these guys are saying this is actual science. And they can put this on a PBS documentary. You know, they can put this on pretty much Channel 5 or whatever and put it on all these digital channels and stations. And then put it on the internet. And then this is why people can't get their heads away from the fact all of this phenomenon was already been explained for thousands of years. That what they're talking about in this alien stuff is really, really brand new. It's like very new. Like you don't even find this in ancient history. You find the same beings in ancient history, you know, but they were seen back then, not as aliens. You know, they were seen under a more demonic format or a more demonic setting, meaning ancient people actually, when it came to spiritual things, were more smarter than the people are today. People have more knowledge in terms of temporal mechanical arts, but they're spiritually dead as a result of them being controlled. And but back in the past, people did not have the, you know, the mechanical arts that they did for, you know, periods of time after the flood. I mean, we're talking centuries, thousands of years. But at the same time, they knew more about what that was. You know, the elitists who actually did have technology, of course, so they hid it in their basement, they knew about it too, because guess who they're getting it from? So it was like the more and more I started realizing about what you call cover-ups and occult secrets, the Bible verifies those things are a reality. That, you know, the pagans back then talked to beings that were, even then, they would claim they're from the sea or they're from under a rock. Even when they gave maybe an alien thing, they would say they're from another planet, but it wasn't so much as they're alien. They would always have something new to say. It was always something new. But always at the same premise, is never to really see it as what they really are, because then you'll be calling on God and they won't, it would be a problem for them. So it's like that tends to be the major reason why we did the video, because it was in the hopes to add another product to certain products that were telling the truth. And it just so happened our product came out at a time when it was barely being told. So that means, like, at the time I had to take the video down, there was about 4 million people worldwide who saw it. And that's kind of telling you how many people really, really, really needed to hear that.
Oh, yes.
Because Yeah, because they weren't hearing it before. And at first they had, like, most of them had negative responses because it was like it was going to happen. Like when the video came out, it was being, oh my God. Like some people were very happy, you know, like, very good job. But I remember getting like 1,000 comments in a row that read, you're a bleep, bleep, you're a bleep, bleep, you're a bleep, bleep. And it was like horrendous. Like, and then I remember just looking at that and just the way it just, that video shocked people. Like either it got them to be positively affected for God, inspired, or it just really made them mad. Like, and I knew only Jesus can do that because it's like, it's the only name in this world that can invoke that.
That's right. Like, well, you got the seed planted.
You know, because I was talking about He-Man or aliens, they would not responded like that. Like, it just would have, they would have been like, ooh, or cool, or, but this made, and it personally affected people, like, personally got under them. Like, and it wasn't even meant to do that. And that's how I knew it was just doing that on its own. Like, because even at the time we made it, I remember I was not as articulate. There was a lot of things I was still learning at the time. So I tried to make the video to be as easy as I possibly could, to just make it as comfortable for people as they possibly can hear it. And for them to turn around and say, you're trying to drive us all crazy. I was like, no, I'm not. You're making yourself crazy. Like, I really wasn't trying to do that. So I just thought to myself, wow, it's like, yeah, we're on, this is a little bit above, this is way beyond us. Whatever we're doing, we're just taking part in it. We're like along for a ride and we don't got control of the steering wheel.
Well, it's so concerning. So that's pretty much how that, because people are being set up and they're setting themselves up for that great deception, the one that we are warned about in the Bible. And it's like they're just falling for everything, hook, line, and sinker.
That's, you're absolutely correct. That's actually why we did it, because in terms of why we do the ministry, because people are being deceived. I don't, you know, I'm not saying I'm a great, perfect person. I'm just saying I don't like seeing people be lied to like that. You know, I know a lot of people talk to each other in many ways, and that's fine. But I don't like to see somebody naive. I just don't. Like, I feel for them in many ways, because it's like I can see where their life or things, how things can happen to them without them knowing things that it's important for them to know. But I just don't like that. I just don't like that. Personally, I just felt like, you know, if it's, the condition is that bad that they need to hear it. So it's best to just say it. And then down the road, you know, I'm sure it'll help them, you know. So,
yes.
Yeah, totally felt you on that. Yeah.
Yeah, because we are, as I always say, we were picked for this time to be born. We have a mission to do,
yeah.
And we have God's word to get out. And that's what we're doing. But once we have done that and we are trying, the rest is up to that person, whether they choose to hear God calling or not. And we can just do what we have to. And you know, Chad and I both agree with you that the aliens are from hell. There are no aliens showing up here from other planets. They are crossing dimensions and they're demonic.
It's funny because that actually, when I first did the teaching on that, when I was telling people about the dimensionals reality and things like that, people don't realize that that was actually being taught like 100 years back. That there were theologians who would actually show pictures to their students, various demons that ancient people saw and talked about. And one of the things that people don't know is that one of the first pictures of a demon that you get to see is in the shape of a UFO. That when in ancient times, when you see these rock paintings and things like that,
mm-hmm.
what you're usually seeing are people who had to go under for whatever reason. It was usually a catastrophic reason, and they literally had to draw and communicate what they saw and what attacked them, because they had to keep their voice down while they were down there because they didn't want to be discovered. And what they would draw are the demons that attack them, and they would look like either UFOs, or they look like gray aliens, or some look like mermaids, some look like giants. They look like these things that we call mythology or movies today, which is funny because if you look at who makes movies, it's the cult groups that make them. And it's like, that's why we did it, because we realized that it's the same old demonological phenomenon. It's the same study. You know, and it's just now that we're calling it something different, that also fulfilled the prophecy in the Bible called mystery of iniquity, that good would be called evil, evil would be called good. So we were fulfilling the prophecies in that way. Like, other events filled other prophecies, of course, but we had a small part in that we literally came out and told people what it was, and we were called evil for it. And people put over all the bad stuff, which was, you know, calling that good. And so that really gave us the understanding then that what we were doing was important, because people can be that deceived and not even know that, you know, like, it just amazes me, you know, that they couldn't even know that. And a lot of the people think that aliens have been around. They've been talking about it for thousands of years. And it's like, no, they haven't been talking about that for thousands of years. They've been talking about something else that looked just like that for thousands of years, but not like that, you know. And we didn't start talking about aliens like that until Hollywood started doing outer space films. Mm-hmm. And then the sci-fi stuff came around and the comic books came around. And that's when we started talking about it. That's when we said, ooh, that could be a possibility, when we got into Star Trek and all that.
Yeah.
That's when we did it.
Oh, and War of the Worlds.
Yeah,
you know,
we didn't do it before.
And,
yeah, you got it.
What was the other
one? H.G. Wells.
Yes.
Yeah. All that. You know, we got into that because it was being taught through entertainment. And we just, since you watch TV, we grew up on television. I don't think there was really a day any of us didn't go by and we didn't look at a screen at some images, or at least not watch it hours at a day. And it just, that was everybody's life. And for the people, I tell people, what do you think people were doing before they watched television?
Mm-hmm.
What do you think the reality was then? You know, it clearly was they knew more back then because they had to see more. More of it was up front then. They weren't distracted as much. You had to be more focused on your work back then. So one thing I noticed is that being very work-focused, I see more, because it's like I'm not focused on the world things all the time. Whereas people don't see anything anymore because they're just not looking. It's just like they're looking at the screen, or they're looking at a movie, or they're looking at whatever is that for them. And they don't kind of take the time to step out of the box and go, maybe there's something a little bit more to life, and I need to start reading the Bible. And yeah, unfortunately, they get taken. And that's kind of sad. But we did it because we wanted people to know.
Well, if you notice, if you look at people going by everyday life, everyone has their head down. No one ever looks up anymore. And
that's very true.
And it disturbs me. I mean, I'm a sky watcher. That's my thing. I love it. I love to be outside looking up. And you just see everyone, they're looking down, or they're looking at their phone, or they just don't have time to look up. And the Bible tells us to look up. Look up. Your redemption draws nigh. You're not going to find it looking down.
Yeah, it's because they're just bogged down in the mud. You know, they got eating bad food, breathing bad air, reading bad stuff, just the things they do. Most people do unhealthy things, and they just can't stop themselves from realizing.
Yeah, it's
the air, you know, smell the roses and things of this sort, which is important to do, but they don't do it because they don't really, there's that soul, that spirit, that God nature, you know, the Holy Spirit,
mm-hmm.
gives person ability to understand life, you know. But people are not responding to that. That's what you get. People don't want to talk to each other. They want to be negative. They can't communicate. They allow too much technology, too much imagery to take over their existence. When you've been raised to have a cell phone, raised to have a computer, raised to have something in your hand or something in front of you 24 hours a day, that's going to make you disconnected. can make you totally antisocial. So now we're dealing with adults now who are raised on this stuff, and you see how disconnected they are. They walk around with their head down. They're not happy. They can't see each other. It's because they're spiritually dead. That's the true reason why. And it's because they've allowed technology and the brainwashed learning to become their religion. God to them, what they don't even want to understand is their politicians, and it's their pleasures. They don't want to understand that because they get offended when you tell them that. But they don't understand that whether they like it or not, we live in a spiritual reality, and that reality has its own intelligence and its own agenda. One agenda is to serve God. The other one ain't, you know. So it's going to use what it's going to use. And if a person wants to be deceived about God, well, God doesn't operate in confusion. And there you have it. And then you get a bunch of people who they got the mercy and grace of God all the time, but they get sucked in by various things because they don't have the full protection, because by their own free will, they're choosing to have something else, you know, rather than try to live a life that is dedicated to trying to be the best you possibly can be. So it's got like this with Christians. It's like Christians are people who are sorry at the end of the day. Worldly people ain't sorry for anything. That's why their heads are down.
Good point. Now, how do you connect CERN with aliens or from hell?
Well, how that happened was, first off, we were studying about ancient technology and government technology. Black op technology. That's how it started with CERN. We learned about the Ender Collider because one of the design patterns on the collider fixed or matched the collider points that we started seeing on the X-ray photos of the Egyptian pyramids. The small tunnel system that's at the middle of it, and then there are various chambers that had connecting parts to it, where there was a central core that was at the bottom that's like buried under the. And its components were in the exact shape as the Ender Collider in Switzerland. And that's how CERN, I was connecting CERN with basically everything else, with that part of the fallen angel technology that's being distributed. Basically, we got to learn that the Egyptian pyramids used to connect and used to actually create a stargate in the past. That in Noah's time, that was something they used, which was basically, the grid, the energy reactors were destroyed by the flood. So that's why you're just left with, two triangular buildings, or three. You know, the third one's technically not part of the structure. It was added to it. But the Ender Collider had the same methodology that it was looking to, well, first they tried to tell people, we're just building it to make better energy, which is bull. I mean, come on, really? If you want to make free energy, you would have done that already. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, that was done like 50 years ago. So we knew that was a lie. And we saw the advanced technology that they were putting into the collider. You know, this is technology people never even heard of. And it's being given to them by United States military, British Black Ops, and British military, French military, even the Russians contributed to it. So I'm like, why are these top agencies giving you the best components, the best circuits, the best computer brains, just so you can make this big giant rod and light it up on Christmas? I was like, God, I didn't think we're that stupid. Really? So so at that point, we started investigating what it was, and that's when we found out a connection with the harp, a connection with, you know, this whole, the alien agenda, basically. The alien agenda points to the fact these beings instructed members of military intelligence to build it. And then periodically, piece by piece, they were giving them inches of the technology, and they were fusing circuit reactors based on the blueprints given to them by military intelligence, representing intelligence seen out of the Bilderbergers. So therefore, we knew that not only could we not get any files because it's in a Bilderberger meeting, tough luck to even get to even find out the players on it, but we knew the agenda nevertheless, because they really couldn't hide it because it's out there, you know? And so by the time we were able to get through it, we were able to realize that it's a piece of fallen angel technology. And it's literally being built as, well, first off, it's testing the parameters of the space-time windows to see how many of those they can open up and how much quantums they can manipulate. But by the time they get that rolling, that's when they're going to attempt to start opening, you know, what's called intergalactic travel for real. Like, that's what the Stargate really was. Mm-hmm. It was just simply a way to just go to another planet. Here, pay me $10 and I'll send you to Mars. Have fun. And that's pretty much what that was back in Noah's time. And that's what they want to bring back, is that stuff that was going on then. And well, obviously it wasn't good, because mankind started out well, but they screwed it all up. And that's pretty basically the story of it, is that they started out intelligent, they were smart, they had technology on their own, but they wanted greater technology. They weren't content with what they had. They weren't content with, you know, just being comfortable with what you have. They wanted more. Then they wanted to be gods, and then we got the flood. It's the same where again. It's them wanting to be gods. I mean, I'm sure when they look at that collider, I'm sure they get, you know, it's, you know, I'm being as honest as I can. Men like that look at the collider, and it's no better than seeing a girl naked for the first time.
Off-limits, that's how they look really. At. Now, are you familiar at all with the Stargate that was found? Stan Deo had been a guest on here, and he'd said that there was a Stargate that was located. Was it in the Mideast, Chad?
You're talking about the one over there in Iraq?
Yes, and it was ordered to be dismantled, but they don't know what became of it after that.
I actually know about that. It was actually a piece of one of the tubes that were built by Nimrod, and that area in Iraq where basically military ops went. It's basically a section of land that's 30 miles out of the green zone. And there it's mostly a desert, but they're cored off and they're controlled by Islamic groups. And military intelligence works with the Sunnis, and they go in there and then they work something out. I can't remember the units because it's various units that do it. It's not just one unit. They will switch up the units so that you get confused in the paperwork. But either way, Black Ops did go there. Their objective really was to retrieve technology that was basically buried in the sand, because there's a tunnel structure down in there, and that's where the bottom base of Nimrod's Tower of Babel is actually there. The rest of it is just on the ground. It's destroyed. But there is a base bottom that was right at it, and that held the gate that he actually built. He built a Stargate there was a piece of it that was supposed to connect on the top of the Tower of Babel. And basically an elevator was constructed to bring it up. It just never got up there because God, as you know, in Genesis had other ideas. So that tower came down. But the base platform was left there. What happened at that moment was the entire language, the whole human race went nuts. Like everybody had mental breakdowns. It was pretty bad. So you got to imagine a scene where people can't understand each other, and they were just talking to each other the other day, and now they can't understand each other. It was a worldwide panic. It was a worldwide, you know, collision, a catalyst of languages and terror. So that gate just got left there because people were too busy killing each other, and they eventually forgot about it. And then, but people knew about it because, you know, certain maps can kind of redirect you to the past again. And military intelligence has been trying to get at that area for like a long, long time. And then they finally got their opportunity in the first Persian Gulf War, but they weren't able to extract because Saddam was still holding that as his, basically his carrot. And so they took everything away from him. And then once they completely got rid of him, that's when they took the pieces of technology. And then one of the things we learned that CERN, about a year after that black op, became almost to the point of fully operational, which is to say that whatever they needed in that desert, they needed it for that component in Switzerland. And that's why they were able to declare themselves nearly fully operational, even though before that black op mission, they were like 20 years behind, which is like it kind of tells you, kind of pieces together some of the puzzles there with that.
Do you believe that there were fallen angels and coming through that? And do you believe that they're coming through CERN right now?
Fallen angels can come into this realm without technology. The reason why they build technology is not for them to become closer to you, because they're already stuck here, according to the Bible. It's for us to get closer to them. so that they can transfer back and forth into our realm, and that'll give them more access way to populate our realm for eventual takeover. That's what that's about. It's a method of war. It's basically fallen angels are dealing with them and telling them lies to make them think you're building it for this reason. But the real reason they're building it is so that they can connect their world to their world, so that the human world connects to their evil world. And by a deal that's struck, that'll give the fallen angel realm the providence or the right to have sway over here. And that's really what it's meant to do. It fulfills a prophecy about iron mixing clay, that there will be a world one day where we'll have to share space with those morons. And that's going to be the result of governments making the most stupidest choices they can ever think to make, because initially they thought they were going to save themselves. This is what this is about, is that for everything, the governments can do good or bad. It all depends on who's running the score. There are people in government that's trying to fight this from happening. So I want to say that first, to be fair. But the ones they fight against, that's what they're trying to create. And that's for that reason. They believe they're gods. They believe they have the divine right to bring about this world catastrophic change, even if it's horrible, just so that mankind can evolve to the next stage of evolution. That is what they really believe. That's what makes them crazy. Whereas the other part is you saying, no, we can't be opening up gates and letting strange beings in here that we don't even know firsthand what they're going to do. And they've already proven to be hostile. They proved it over and over again. When you're finding dead bodies, it doesn't get any more hostile than that. So it's that's what we have, is that in military intelligence, there's an internal war going on. So that part is real. We just don't know the components or how it all unfolds. I've seen pieces of it. I can tell you it involves cloak and dagger operations, and it involves some real bad assassinations. But it's real bad nevertheless, because it's all designed to hold back disclosure until the other side can explain it the way they want to. And I think by the time they're ready to pull that together, I think that rabbit will already be out of the hat, because it's already coming out. So it's like, I don't really know what more they can really do other than they need to expose the fact there's a problem in our government. And the next civil strife is really going to have to take place with the government itself, not to say overthrow the government, but to say start cleaning your house is what that really is going to have to be about.
Fascinating.
That's pretty much.
I'd never heard it put that way.
Yeah, because I don't know. I mean, some people are closer to the information than others. And I was pretty close with government projects because I had to learn about them, because I was a victim to them when I was a kid, and even when I began as a young adult. So it was like I had to learn, sort of like the Bible says, physician, heal thyself. That means learn what they did to you, learn what they do to others, so that when you learn that, it's really impossible for them to do something to you if you can see it coming, So, but that's really what that was, because the more you learn about that, you learn about the connections of where all the funding comes from, because it comes from basically Jake accounts and set up subsidiary company accounts, mostly charity groups and all political groups. But when you look at what they pay for, it's the same type of stuff, paying for microwave frequencies, paying for gravity technology, they're paying for plasma reactors, suppressing books on nuclear energy, suppressing books on quantum mathematics. Like, why would you do that? It's obvious, because it's to keep it for themselves. And we realized that, all this stuff, all the information was going somewhere, and what we're getting back is it's also coming from the same source. And we realized that we're just being taken. We're just being taken by big corporations working for governments, and all wrapped up within military corps. So politicians, I don't really see them as much of a threat, other than they're always working for someone. So when I think about Project CERN, it's a bunch of European monarchs with their pet project. It's really what you get, Like if you want something done about CERN, you might have to talk to the Swedish princess. And people go, what? yeah, that's how bad it is. this is where we've gotten back to, that we were a country starting out that said no more monarchies. This is where we're at now. We're now asking them permission if we can do this. And why are we doing that? Because those monarchs found a way to screw us politically, so the only thing that keeps us free is our military, while economically we got to deal with them, whether we like it or not. That's the stranglehold. And I haven't seen one politician, not a Trump or a Hillary, even come out and even address that. I was proud of Trump for at least saying that Christians were persecuted in America, but that was it. That was the only outside thing that I heard out of his mouth. The same thing, Hillary is she's going to jail. Oh my God, I don't want to talk about it. But anyway, no politician is really telling you anything. They're just telling you a bunch of stuff so that you'll at the end of the day vote and whatever, and go have a big media shebang. But after, you know, that's all of this is really in the hands of basically political groups, and they're the ones controlling the world right now.
Do you see a link between CERN and Gothard Tunnel? There was so much satanic and evil about the opening of Gothard Tunnel. Do you see a relationship there?
The relationship basically is that when you talk about high-level sorcery technology like CERN is, it usually comes from an understanding within the spiritual realm of how things work. So I'll tell you a little bit about tunnels, why these guys like tunnels. For one thing, tunnels are always underneath the ground. They're dark, and they're more connected to the realms that these things come from. So often they build very deep, deep tunnels underneath the city because it's like one step away from being away from hell. It's kind of how they feel that. They do it for ambiance. Demons like ambiance because they're very, very tortured. They're very, very, you know, in a state of chaos. So the more ambiance, the more quiet, the more darker, the more willing they're willing to appear in areas like that. It feels comfortable for them. So that's the major reason they go into a tunnel. Tunnels have also energy, and because it's more connected down into the earth, the further down into the earth you go, the more energy is there. You don't see it, but it's within the walls, it's within the rocks, and within the very elements themselves. Now, since you're only a human being, you obviously can't tap into that. So the reason that a cult group will build something very, very down in there is because their spirits can tap into that. And those spirits can transfer that energy into them. It literally becomes a euphoric worship site where they really become very animalistic in that setting. The reason why they kill children down in those tunnels and do these sacrifices is because, A, you can easily dispose of the body. You can make it disappear. Nobody will know what's going on. The other factor is it's the most hellish place you can bring somebody. It provides the most terror to the victim. The victim will be the most afraid. And the more terrified, the better for them. I'm sorry I'm saying that, but that's the way they think. This is why they use tunnels, because tunnels primarily have the demonic energy that they get off on. CERN is built like that. It's built as an energy reactor. It's built with the same principle premises why you would build a tunnel structure, why you would build an underground city. Every occult process is always done for their type of energy, and it's always done to manifest something. So you're building tunnels as a way to get closer to what they love is why they do that. And they build CERN because that's what they're instructed to do from the things they meet in the tunnels. And they always start from the bottom to the top because I guess for Satan's aspect, since Satan is trapped at the bottom realms, naturally it is going to happen that way. It's going to be evil from the very bottom working its way all the way up, because that's kind of how Satan is working himself, from the bottom all the way up.
We got to this portion of the interview and we're disconnected. We were able to reconnect with Michael for a short time, but none of the equipment was working, so we had to end the interview at that point. But Michael has graciously agreed to come back for another portion of the interview, part two, and you will hear that next week. And we get much more into detail on a lot of different things. We're sorry for the inconvenience, and we thank you for tuning in and for your patience. God bless all of you.
That's going to do it for tonight, everyone. We appreciate you tuning in. We pray that you all have a blessed week. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Into the night, I raise my hand to the fire, but it's no use, 'cause you can't stop it from shining through. It's true, baby, let the light.